was driving home from work one night, around 11 p.m. I had just finished a long shift at a hospital, and I was exhausted. I lived in a rural area, and the road to my house was dark and winding. There were no street lights, and the only other cars I saw were the occasional trucks passing by. I was listening to some music on the radio, trying to stay awake, when I noticed something odd. The radio station started to fade in and out, and then it switched to a different station. I tried to change it back, but it wouldn't work. The radio kept switching between different stations, playing random snippets of songs, commercials, and static. I thought it was weird, but I didn't pay much attention to it. I figured it was just some interference or a glitch. I reached for my phone, hoping to use it as a GPS or a flashlight, but it was dead. I had forgotten to charge it before I left work. I felt a pang of annoyance, but I shrugged it off. I knew the road well enough, and I was almost home. I just had to drive for another 15 minutes or so. I continued driving, ignoring the radio, when I saw something in the corner of my eye. It looked like a person standing on the side of the road. He was wearing a dark hoodie and jeans, and he had his thumb out, as if he was hitchhiking. I slowed down a bit, wondering if I should stop and help him. He looked harmless enough, but I had heard stories of people being robbed or killed by hitchhikers. I decided to keep driving, hoping he would find another ride. As I passed by him, I glanced at his face. He had no face. Where his eyes, nose, and mouth should be, there was only smooth skin. He had no features at all. I gasped and slammed on the brakes. I looked back at him, but he was gone. There was no sign of him anywhere. I felt a surge of fear and confusion. What did I just see? Was it a hallucination? A prank? A ghost? I tried to calm myself down, telling myself that I was just tired and stressed. Maybe I had fallen asleep at the wheel for a second and dreamed it up. Maybe it was a trick of the light or a shadow. I decided to keep driving, hoping to get home as soon as possible. I turned on the radio again, hoping to hear something familiar and comforting. But instead of music or news, I heard a voice. A voice that sounded like him. The voice said, "Hello there." I screamed and swerved off the road. The car crashed into a tree and everything went black. I don't know what happened after the crash. I woke up in a hospital bed with bandages and bruises all over my body. The doctors told me that I had a concussion, a broken arm, and some internal injuries. They said I was lucky to be alive. They also told me that they found no trace of the hitchhiker. They said he must have run away after the crash, or maybe he was never there in the first place. They said it was possible that I had a psychotic episode, or a severe case of pareidolia, which is when you see faces where there are none. They said they checked the radio station that I was listening to, and they found nothing unusual. They said it was just a normal station, playing normal music and ads. They said there was no voice that said hello there. They said I was imagining things. But I know what I saw. I know what I heard. He was real. He is still out there, and he is coming for me. Well past midnight when I finally left my friend's house after a late night of video games and hanging out. Now I just had to make the 45-minute drive home through winding country roads. I said goodbye, got in my car, and headed off into the darkness. I always loved night drives. There was something so peaceful about the empty roads with just my headlights cutting through the blackness. I rolled the windows down to feel the cool night air whipping around me. About 15 minutes into the drive, I realized I was running low on gas. Of course, being out here in farm country, there weren't exactly many 24-hour stations to stop at. I'd just have to keep an eye out for one and hope I came across something soon. After a few more miles, my gas light started blinking. I was close to empty. My heart sank as I squinted into the distance, desperately hoping to spot a lit-up station. Finally, I came across an old rundown gas station on the side of the highway. It didn't look very inviting, but it was likely my only option out here. I pulled up next to the single ancient pump and shut my engine off. The place was deserted, not a soul around. My unease grew. I pumped my gas as quickly as I could, wanting nothing more than to get back on the open road. Just as I was about to climb back into my car, the overhead lights at the station suddenly clicked off, plunging me into sheer darkness. I froze in place, unsure what to do next. Had the power gone out? Or did someone intentionally turn the lights off? I stood paralyzed in confusion when I heard the unmistakable sound of footsteps crunching gravel nearby. My pulse pounded in my ears. I leapt back into my car, slammed the door shut, and locked it. Fumbling to start the ignition, I kept hearing the footsteps draw steadily closer. Finally, the engine roared to life, and I floored it back onto the road, my heart racing. I let out a huge sigh of relief once the glow of the taillights faded into the distance. I tried to calm my rattled nerves and focus on just getting home safely. About 10 miles down the highway, blue and red flashing lights appeared in my rearview mirror. A police cruiser was pursuing me with its siren blaring. I pulled over, confused why I was getting pulled over, but also a bit relieved to see another human. The gruff officer accused me of skipping out on paying for gas. I explained it was a mistake. The lights had shut off, and I got scared when I heard noises. But the cop was having none of it. He ordered me out of the car to perform a sobriety test. I nervously got out and followed his instructions, walking the line heel to toe. Apparently, I failed the test, so he barked at me to put my hands on the hood and proceeded to pat me down. Finding nothing, he then reached into my pockets, pulling out a small plastic bag. What do we have here? He asked snidely. I looked in shock as he held up a bag of white powder. But it wasn't mine. He slapped cuffs on me and shoved me into the back of the cruiser, reading me my rights. I pleaded desperately that I'd been set up, but he just ignored me. We pulled into a police station where he fingerprinted me and led me straight to a holding cell, saying I could explain everything to the judge in the morning. But I knew with that bogus evidence, no one would believe me. I sat there in that cold, empty cell all night, terrified of what awaited me in court. Just a few hours ago, I had been excited for a simple drive under the stars. Now I found myself trapped in the twisted darkness of this night gone horribly wrong. I was driving home from a late night shift at the diner around 3 a.m. I had just finished serving the last customer, and I was looking forward to getting some sleep. I lived in a small town, and the road to my house was lonely and dark. There were no streetlights, and the only other cars I saw were the occasional police patrol or drunk driver. I was listening to some music on the radio, trying to stay alert, when I noticed something odd. The car behind me was following me too closely. It was a red pickup truck with a dent on the side and a loud muffler. It had been behind me for a while, and it seemed to match my every turn and speed. I thought it was weird, but I didn't pay much attention to it. I figured it was just some random guy who happened to live near me, or maybe he was lost and needed directions. I decided to ignore him, hoping he would go away. He didn't. He kept following me, getting closer and closer. He started to flash his high beams at me and honk his horn. He tried to pass me, but there was no room. He tried to bump me, but I swerved away. He was harassing me. He was stalking me. I started to panic and wondered who he was and what he wanted. I didn't know him, or at least I didn't think I did. I didn't have any enemies or rivals that I knew of. I didn't owe anyone money or favors. I didn't have any secrets or scandals that could expose me. I was just a normal girl, living a normal life. Why was he after me? I decided to call 911, hoping to get some help. I reached for my phone, but it was dead. I had forgotten to charge it before I left the diner. I felt a surge of fear and frustration. I was trapped in my car with no way to contact anyone. And then I remembered him, the guy from the diner. The guy from the diner. The guy who'd been staring at me all night. The guy who had left a note on my windshield. The note that said, "I know where you live." He was the stalker. He had followed me home. He knew where I lived. He knew where I lived. He wanted to hurt me. I screamed and sped up. The car crashed into a tree and everything went black.